Let's welcome Lorenzo. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Lorenzo, and I think you guys know me more than I know myself, maybe, through the book and the articles and all that stuff that you guys have read. So I'll tell you guys a little bit about the stuff that you guys don't read in the book, the things that you probably did read in the book, but are beyond the book. So I was brought over from Mexico when I was 9 months old, and I was raised in Phoenix, Arizona. Since then, I'm 28 years old now. And I had a very difficult life. I'm one of five. After me, all my siblings are from Mexico, from here in the United States. I have one older brother, his name is Jose. And the younger ones, you know, two males and one female, they all are from here. So I live in a mixed status family. Meaning that, you know, you get different perceptions, you know. They'll be like, oh, you should go to work when you can't go to work, when you don't have a social security number, you know. And so that's kind of like, you know, a little bit. The other part is we moved a lot. So we lived in the downtown area, which the downtown area is now nice. Then it was very, very violent. There's a lot of gang-related activities, a lot of drugs. A lot of homeless people, a lot of abandoned buildings. So we lived in that neighborhood, you know. And we lived also with family, so we moved from place to place. We moved about 5 or 6 times. And being a kid, it's very difficult to become friends and be social when you're constantly moving, when you don't have that sense of comfortableness of, you know, 1 or 2 people from the class from the last year. It just made it difficult, you know? So that's kind of like where it adds up to me being a troublemaker, getting into fights, you know, that you guys read in the book, and you guys seen some of the documentary. In high school, fast forward to the high school stuff, I had one friend, and that one, I called him my best friend, and realizing that he was not good, you know, not a good best friend ever. So his mom got deported because of the, you know, 10-year ban. You have to go to Mexico to wait for 10 years to come back and all that. So she gets deported and he leaves and I lose my one best friend. Now what do I do? Well, I tried joining the band. And I was like, well, I play piano. I'm really good at playing piano. But I couldn't play with people. So I couldn't do that. Like, I couldn't fit in because it wasn't what I did. They didn't like me or I didn't like them or we just didn't mix. So, yeah. And then I'm in the marine science class. The teacher, Freddy Lajavardi, he's a marine science teacher. And he's always talking about this robotics team. And I'm all like, ooh, that sounds interesting. But I don't know. Like, I don't know anybody there. I just don't want to try it. But then I'm all like, let's try it out. See what happens. You know, I was helping him feed the fish. And then he shows me the robotics room. In the robotics room, it had tools. Had things you could break stuff with, you could build stuff with, you know, you could imagine up things that, I mean, I didn't have that access at home because my dad was always working. We didn't have a lot of tools, we didn't have a lot of things, so why should I, you know, do that? On top of that, in my house, my dad was always drunk, my mom was always working, and both of them were always working. I lived in a house, a 3-bedroom apartment house, with about 15 or 16 people. Sometimes we slept on a couch, then we got moved to the room where we had like military style bunk beds. So three or four of us slept in one room. And that sucked, you know. Everything, all your stuff is in a little corner. It was a mess because nobody cleaned it and nobody had the responsibility, so. We lived in that environment. It just kind of sucked. You don't want to be there. So I went to the robotics room. That was my escape. That was the way of running away from home without actually running away. And what did I do? Instead, I just stayed in the robotics room until they kicked us out. And that was like 6, sometimes 7. Sometimes we were building the land robots. We stayed up till 9 at night, and then I would walk home, which was fine because it didn't matter. It was me and a brother or me by myself. It was cool, you know, nothing happened. Well, that's that. I was a failing student. I was on my way to being expelled. I was in high school. I was 16 years old. I'm 28 years old now. I knew that I wanted to go to college. I just didn't know how to get there. I didn't know that there was people that would offer things. And I wasn't understanding that I was a perfect A grade student with a GPA of 3 point plus whatever GPA status. I wasn't the role model. I was not. I don't even, like, sometimes I surprise myself because how could a student that was that bad be here today? You know, it's. But that changed, you know, that changed through my story. I think that people like how I am because I'm like being funny and I make them laugh and I'm very serious. But anyways, whatever. That's nothing to do with it. So, I joined this robotics team. We're at that time, right before we joined this, entered the underwater robotics competition. We had a few other competitions as well. We had a trebuchet competition, and that was building catapults and, you know, throwing pumpkins and trying to, you know, get those to like, you know, certain areas where you have to hit the target. We had a land robot, and that robot we had to build in 6 weeks and then go compete with it in March. And that was in January. So between building the underwater robot and all the other things we had to do, we're building, you know, the robot, we're building the other robot, we're building a catapult. We had a lot of things going on. Like, it doesn't show in the documentary or the book, but we had a lot of stress already. On top of that, school. School was like the side job. It was like, do it, you know, when you get home at night, stay up till 11. But that was like the perk of it. You didn't look forward to going to class. You look forward to going to the robotics room, you know? Lunch was like that. We always built, you know, working on the robots all the time. I actually have I built my finger and I like turned pale because I was trying to get this thing done. Anyways, so those are the things that are not in the, I don't think they're in the book that much. One of the things that we don't talk about in the book either is that we didn't beat MIT once. We taught them 3 times. And then what happened the year after was more interesting because May, the competition we entered, Marine Advanced Technology Education, they moved their competition to Canada. And we asked them, why did you do that? And their answer was, just bring your students that are from here. But you would be splitting our team up because you don't want us to compete. And they knew that we're always together. So why did they move it? We experienced racism right away, right there. They didn't want our publicity because we were giving them publicity. The publicity that wasn't giving it to the colleges so that those students that were already going to college and gonna be graduating, we're gonna have that opportunity to, you know, have the exposure that MIT, the great MIT, is able to do all these things and they should go to college, they should go get hired by, you know, the top engineering firms and companies and things that we didn't even get access to. We did it 3 times and we didn't have the opportunity to do those, you know, go into engineering. We didn't get MIT to invite us to go to college, you know. Those are things that I said, they're not mentioned. They're portrayed in the documentary very well because I like the way that our director, Mary Mazio, portrays this. She says, she shows MIT when they graduate college, they're doing all these engineering, beautiful engineering jobs. They're looking for Amelia Earhart. One of them is working for the Apple company, making headphones. And you know, they're doing amazing work. You know, they're getting paid $100,000+ a year, starting their, you know, their amazing lives because they're white and we're not. What we got when we graduated from high school, there was no scholarships. We didn't get, you know, amazing paid jobs. We didn't get any of that. society already labeled us. We're Mexican, we have color skin, and we don't belong in this country because of our background, because of where we come from. Because we're not from this country and we don't belong here. But you know what? At the end of the day, that's not something that should stop us. I didn't sit there and cry and stop my life. I'm like, well, you gotta be a Mexican. You gotta think on your feet. And what it was immediate to me, what I thought was gonna be an amazing career goal, because I love art. I love knowing that people would be happy, and that was cooking. And then it keeps my culture intact, because when we leave the country, we leave our home countries, it's very easy to forget where we're coming from. And food is culture to anybody. You know, it reminds you of home. You eat frijoles, you eat, you know, beans, you eat tortillas, you eat salsa in the mortar and pestle. It's called molcajete. And that's something that reminds you of home. But we forget it. We want to eat burgers, pizza, pasta. We want to eat everything that's American, because we want to look just like everybody else. And that's something that I think I don't want to lose. I know I don't want to lose. I don't want to lose cooking beans. I don't want to lose cooking rice. I don't want to lose making all the amazing food that we have. Because even though that I could have had all these engineering positions or been just as competitive as anybody else, culture is more important to me than it is to have an engineering job. I'm not saying that you guys shouldn't go to find an engineering job. It's good. I'm saying I love cooking. So. And so we joined this competition, you know, we'll build a robot, and we're all undocumented. None of us knew where each other was undocumented, and that was one of the biggest things, you know. Why are we hiding it? We never hid it. Nobody ever asked us, right? So when the reporter, Joshua Davis, the writer of the book, starts investigating, he figures out that we're all undocumented. He throws that out in the book. I know in the first article, I don't know if you guys have heard of Wired Magazine. That's the first article that ever came out, and it stated that we were undocumented. Without us knowing, it came out, we read it, the teachers freaked out because we didn't know what it meant. I just read it and I'm like, cool, like, this is a cool article, it's so long. somebody wrote this long ass article about us. You know, we got photo shoots, we got, you know, a picture with my long mullet, you know. You know, it was cool because you got to see all these things, you know, photographers, you got to see writers, you get exposed to things that we've never been exposed to. Because our school was in the ghetto, it was known as the gang school, nobody wanted to report on us, and if it was because it was a bomb threat, somebody just had fought, or it was a gang-related activity. And we were about to change that, we just didn't know that. So along comes our writer, Joshua Davis, and he starts writing, and then he writes that, like I said. And then everything goes crazy. People want to start, you know, doing Nightline. Right? I think you guys might have heard of Nightline. It's before Underwater Dreams and Spare Parts, there was a bunch of articles, even in Mexico, we got into. Around the country, like around the world, it was just so crazy. People knew us from everywhere. And Nightline was Stephanopoulos, the guy that was recording us. And we got a 30-minute show on ABC, primetime television, one of the weeknights when everybody's watching, and they wanted to have us say or talk about our immigration status. Meaning that if we weren't gonna say that, they weren't gonna publish it, or they weren't gonna report on us. So we had to talk about it. And that was a big decision. So teachers put us aside, before we do this thing, principal advice is not to do it, because if we do, we could get the sheriff, our file on us, immigration, ICE, whatever. So it was interesting because we all sat down, we talked about it, conversation was pretty tough. You know, talking about coming out as being undocumented on national television 10 years ago, 12 years ago, was unheard of. It was taboo. You should not say it because you're going to get deported. The whole world's going to know you, and you know, you should be scared. You need to be scared and fear. And we, you know, we all talked about it. Teachers told us, go home, talk to your parents. I told my mom, you know what, I want to do it. I made her cry because I'm going to separate my family. I'm gonna tear the family apart. And I shouldn't do it because it's not good, because I'm going to be the worst guy in the world. And I've always been the rebel. I don't know if you guys noticed. So I told her, you know, no matter what happens, no matter how, if we're together, you know, separated, we'll find a way to get together. But like I told you guys earlier, my siblings, my three younger siblings are from here. So that's what she means, you know. If we all got deported, that's great. But three of us are from here. So we would be separating them and they would get sent to, you know, government protection or whatever, you know, government funded programs to help them take care of kids and get an outfit or whatever. So that's where she was scared. Well, I just told her, this needs to happen. We need to do it. It's already out in the world. Nothing has happened so far. Nothing will happen now. And I told her, there's a lawyer. You know, don't worry. Don't be scared. We're going to be defended. Don't trip. And she was still scared. I made her cry. Like I said, it was very emotional. I've always been the bad guy in the family. But so we come back and we talk about why we're doing it. You know, we all say, yeah, we're going to share our story. We're going to put it in national TV. The thing is that one of us said, I don't know, I think I said it. I want to say, I don't take the credit. I said that it could be a Rosa Parks moment, going back to the Civil War era, because we're civil rights era, because we had already learned about all the things that, you know, black people and their injustices, and we're reliving that currently. We're living that because every day we're pushed back, you know, education is being cut every day. In college, tuition has increased so much, it's ridiculous. It's really impossible for a person that lives in a big family like us to go to college. If I was, you know, I was one of five, and I couldn't have gone to college if I didn't get the funding I had from the world through Wire magazine. So, you know, just those, you know, those are Parks moment right there. And all of us decided, let's do it. It was a scary moment, but at the same time, it was a moment that changed the way that we would think. We would break our barriers mentally and, you know, for our own good, for our well-being of, you know, bringing up a standard for everybody that came after us. Because it wasn't just about us anymore, it was about everyone that's in here that come after us, that's going to college, that's trying to thrive, that's coming from any country in the world, no matter where you're coming from, being an immigrant and trying to succeed. I think that's 20 minutes. Let's talk about you guys. Let's hear questions about you. I just wanted to throw some points out there, you know, some key things. And I think you guys should be taking notes. I'll hint you to take notes, because you might need them for later. Just saying, you know. I'm not a teacher. I'm just a friendly advisor. Let's say in that lady's class over somewhere, or her. Someone, I don't know. Just saying. Anyways, I want to hear from you guys. I know that you guys know me very personally through the book, through the documentary. If you guys have any concerns, questions, you know, advice, whatever you want to talk about, let's talk about it. I think that I want to hear more from you guys, because the way that when we were emailing back and forth, you guys were more excited to meet me. Oh, I'm very excited to meet you guys because of the enthusiasm that you guys radiate through me. So let's get to asking.
Isn't it powerful? Amazing, right? Yeah, let's give a applause. All right, thank you so much.
how I would.
Thank you, Lorenzo. I want to ask you to send a message for new students. They are come new immigrants here in the United States.
I think a message for new students coming to the United States is never give up on your dreams, because those are what keeps you alive, you know? I know people that have, that are older than me, still going to college, that really want their degree, you know? And they're not giving up because of how much money they make or because they have a family. They're going to get their PhDs, their masters, and that's amazing. Never give up on those dreams. Don't give up on what you really want to do. Because at the end of the day, it's your dream.
Thank you, Lorenzo. I'm Joaquim from the DRC. My question is this one. After the thing you've done in your book, I mean, you and your teammates are just for engineering guys, but you went to that competition, you faced great teams like MIT and all those teams. So after your triumph against those teams, people consider you as hero, as any one of the four heroes. That's why I think everyone is here. We think that you're a hero. So do you consider yourself as a hero, or do you just consider yourself as Lorenzo, the guy from Mexico?
That's a good question. I've never been asked that. I've never been considered a hero either. Wow, that's a tremendous honor. And do I look like a Superman? Do I look like an Iron Man? No, we just watched Civil War, and that was amazing. I'm actually living proof of what you can do. Like I said earlier, I'm the worst example that could come here. I don't know why I'm here though, you know? I just know that I changed my mentality for a better future, you know? And if I can do it, I had the worst GPA, I think I just barely scraped by. If I could do that, anybody could do, you know, what they set their minds to. They'd probably do a better, amazing job than me. So there's nothing to stop you, and I should be the proof of that. You know, I was in a mixed belt. I had bad grades, I had bad fights, I had anger issues. I still do, but it all worked out. You know, and if it's all that, you know, I'm not a hero. I'm just an example of what you guys can accomplish, even more.
Okay, thank you. The next person, and please.
Hi, everyone. This is not a question. I just wanted to thank Lorenzo, because we have learned a lot of things about him. And one of the things that I learned is not giving up, because I am from Guatemala, and I came here 5 years ago. I didn't have papers at first. And then about 2 years ago, I finally got my papers. And I'm learning English right now. And I know it's really hard for all of us, because I think all of us here are ESL students. And Lorenzo, tú eres una persona como un héroe para nosotros, porque la verdad hemos aprendido mucho del libro y estamos muy agradecidos. Thank you so much, Lorenzo, and this is for it, for you.
Okay, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to ask, but I just want to say, Lorenzo, that I enjoyed your story because we have similar experience about bullying. So it made I just want to say thank you so much. And like I said, I cried and I laughed with your story. So thank you so much.
don't be afraid to ask me anything or say anything. I'm just human, just like you guys. And I also am an ESL student. I just experienced it at a very young age. And my learning was curse words, so I'm not saying you gotta learn like that, but if, you know, like I said, I had to learn it, I went through the process, I had a Mexican accent when I was 16 years old, and I think when you guys watch the Nightline, you'll notice that accent, and then throughout the years, it just changed, and that's because I didn't really think I was gonna be a public speaker, but that changed in the past few weeks. I've been in Chicago, Boston, California, Sacramento, San Diego, Humboldt State up north, Texas, I've been to Puerto Rico, New York. I've traveled about 25 states in the past 2 years. And I honestly didn't think that I would be doing something like this. There's four guys, Christian is way smarter. He probably had better answers than me. And everywhere that I've been invited, it's been a very big blessing. Just like this, it was a short notice, but I love it because you guys are the people that I want to talk to, that I want to hear from. Because we're all in this together. This is our story of struggle, and we could all contribute to it in a systemic way to prove to the government that we can change this country for the better.
Lorenzo, one top is transpass all the book as the immigration. And what do you suggest for us to do in relation to immigration? Before, I had one question for you, but I saw in the video you joined the protest in front of the bus. I had the question, if you guys get involved in some protest, advocate in favor of the immigrants. So is what do you suggest for us? You what you can do for advocate in favor of the immigrants?
That was a really good, important question because right now we're facing a dilemma, guys. You guys know the presidency, I don't talk too much about it, but if you guys have somebody that can vote, you can influence them to vote the right way. Just put it that way. Pay attention to who candidate you want to be your president. If you cannot vote, get somebody to vote. And immigration-wise, everybody can get involved in civic change, you know? You could get involved in your local battles because at the end of the day, I don't know California really well. I don't know the politics. I don't know how San Francisco works or Oakland. But any proposition or any law that it gets voted into, you guys have the power to do something about it. If it hurts you, try not to get it, you know, get it passed. Because it's not good, you know, not for you. And that's what we realized. In Arizona, we got Proposition 300. That quadrupled our tuition. That means that if I was a citizen and I paid, you know, $200 per class, you would pay $1,500 for that one class that I would go to. Would you want that? No, you wouldn't, right? You would suck. You would be impossible. In Arizona, we had our governor, that's amazing governor, Jan Brewer. She decided, you know what? All immigrants that have DACA, Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, you don't deserve to drive, right? So she signed an executive order that we wouldn't be allowed to drive. I'm in that category. the organization I'm with, we decided to sue her, and we just won. It wasn't me, it was a group. It's called Arizona Dream Act Coalition. There's a lot of local groups that are advocating for immigrants' rights, whether it's Asian, whether it's Indian, whether it's Black, whether it's Congo. Congo? Whether it's whatever country you're from, there's something that's gonna affect you. And any immigrant should pay attention to that, no matter where you're from, because it's gonna affect you somehow. And if it hurts one of your partners in here, because you probably won't see him tomorrow. So pay attention to your local propositions, local laws. Get involved with your, maybe there's an organization here in this college that I don't know about that you guys can join. Look around, you'll find it. I think that's the best advice I could give for everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Thank you. Lorenzo, thanks for being here. It's an honor for us to meet you in person. Your story really impacted my life because we have a lot of things in common, probably because we are Latinos. And one of the things I want to say is like we have one of the things in common, like both of us like Hooters. That's one of the things you mentioned in the book. But I want to ask you something. I'm a little curious about what happened with the other guys. Are they, are you still in touch with them? Because I'm like a little curious, what are they doing right now? Are they still studying? Or you, what's next? What's going to be, are you guys still in touch or stalking? Have family now, married or still young, single? I don't know. Just want to know, a little curious.
Wow, I forgot to ask, and that was like in the email. I was supposed to talk about that, guys. I'm so selfish, I'm sorry. Anyways, Oscar, he self-deported and then came back to the United States. And then he joined the military where he did a tour of duty in Afghanistan. And then he did active duty in Alaska for a few years, moved to Montana and got hired by the BNSF Railroad Company. So now he's an engineer, manager, person, and he lives in Texas. He got transferred. So here's a huge story of success. The one thing I want to say is that Senator Dick Durbin advocated for him, and a lot of people helped him get his citizenship, right? And that's one of the things that I point out, because if all four of us did that, maybe I wouldn't have had that, because I didn't have that all that amazing good standing, good grades, you know, all that good stuff. So it won't work for everybody, and don't try it, please. So Oscar has two kids, and he's married. So yeah, two kids, and they're like older, like you know, 4 or 5 or something like that. And Luis, he's a manager at a janitorial company, but on the weekends and when I need him, we work together in a catering company. Christian, to the success of the documentary, he lost his scholarship opportunities because of the laws that happened in Arizona, probably hundreds and all that, and pro citizenship and all that. So he lost that, and then he got depressed. But recently, with the success of the movie and the documentary, somebody said, hey, you're going to college, I'm going to help you out. So he has a full tuition scholarship with room and books and whatnot and food to go to Detroit University. He's in Detroit somewhere. I just don't know what the university is. And but he's doing good. He's going back to college and getting a degree. And I don't want to talk about me. I already talked too much. So I got 9 months ago. I told you guys I was traveling 25 states, right? I got fired from my day job. I worked in a restaurant, it was called St. Francis. You guys can look it up, it's really good. And it was, I worked there for 3 years. We did like 500 covers in one morning from
which is a lot for the amount of sitting they have in the restaurant, which is 70. Anyways, they fired me because I was traveling. And I'm like, cool, well, I figured something out. And, sorry. So they fired me. And actually, the bosses are like, come back. And I'm like, oh. So as soon as I got fired, I was coming back from Boston. And I'm like, what do I do? Well, I decided to legalize our catering company. And so Luis and I own a catering company. It's called Ni de aquí, Ni de allá catering. In English, it means not from here or from there. And that's because we're not accepted here in the United States, really. And we're really not raised in Mexico ever. So we're not, if we ever go back, like, who do we go to, right? So that's where the play of the restaurant, the name of the restaurant, LLC, goes to play in the kind of shows legally what it is. Anyways, so I have two babies. I'm not married. Well, okay. My baby girl, she's 2 years old, and then my son is 3 months. And, yeah. So, pretty cute.
Hello, everyone. I'm an international student from Vietnam. Nice to meet you today. By reading spare parts, I know that Freddie has significant effects on your life. He changed your life a lot. So can you tell us more how important Freddie was in your life?
To me, Freddie, honestly, was a father figure. He was the guy that, when my dad wasn't there, he fathered me. And I thank him every day for the rest of my life for that. I told you guys I lived a very difficult life, and he just straightened me out with harsh words and reality, you know. Every time I try to go see him every once in a while, but every time I see him, I see more gray hairs on him, you know. And that's just from age. But he's been a good person. Every time that I had something going on that wasn't good, he always talked, pulled me to the side and took a half an hour. An hour and just talk to me about it. Why I shouldn't do it, what I need to be doing, what it should be my focus. And that was something that I didn't have from my dad, you know, because he was always drunk. He was always doing other things that didn't involve raising us. And I honestly have felt like that all my life. This guy just, you know, Iranian guy, looked like a Mexican. My apologies. For the other guys, same thing. Christians, same thing. You know, all of us, he always had some advice for us. You know, always gave advice, good advice for us.
Hi, I'm so happy to meet you today. Thanks for coming to Laney College. I'm curious to know, what are your plans for the future? How do you feel about coming to
Laney
College today?
My plan for the future is to open up a restaurant in California. Somebody had nice playing. Psych! I tricked you guys. I forgot to come to Arizona. That was bad. Nobody wants you to open up a restaurant. But my plans is actually fully run. It's actually a food bus. It's not a food truck. And I want to have a mobile kitchen so that I can cater for 300 plus people without having to worry about having a kitchen. Because that's like one of our biggest issues. Like 2 weekends ago, we did 125 people. And you know, potatoes, mashed potatoes, real vegetables. It was an amazing. fish. And it rained on us. Like, we had a canopy and we were cooking out there. And we got it done, but we didn't have a kitchen. So that's always been our problem. And we always run into the issue of not having an oven or a deep fryer, and that is true with everything else. So, whatever that's the feature. And there was another question you asked. Where are you? Oh, I feel amazing. You guys are radiating an energy that is really cool. I've been to places where it's scary because these kids are high school kids and they're like, support Donald Trump and I have to talk to them. It's just scary. It's scary. But today it's just really cool to share our story, to see the amount of diversity there is in any college, from Guatemala to Mexico to, I see too many ways to acknowledge. But you guys are amazing. The diversity is just great. And I love that. I love that about it. And everybody has an accent, which I feel home.
Thank you very much, Lorenzo. Thank you for coming. And the story in the book inspired me so much. I just nearly came to the United States for a couple of years and also experienced lots of hardship. So my question to you might be a little hard time. So I would like to know that in the school, when the kids mocked you because of your appearance, how did you overcome those hard feelings? One. And the second one, so I'm a little curious about the relationship between you and your father. I know that before he's not so supportive to the kid. I want to know, how do you feel and how did you overcome this and become so strong and creative? So great.
So the bullying, I had a long hair, and my mom wanted me to have it, so I just listened to her, and, you know, I'm a good kid, very good. And so I just listened to her, and I remember my mom telling me, don't listen to them, because at the end of the day, they're crazy, and you're more of a man for having long hair. And that is true, in a sense, like, it wasn't about like having the long hair, it was just that, why are you bothering somebody that's just going to school, you know? And I didn't get bullied, I got dumped throwing my hair, I got called a bookie, Joe Dirt, you know, offensive names that you're like, man, I'm not even your friend and you're calling me these things. And that's what just threw me off, you know? But at the end of the day, knowing that my mom, you know, loved my hair, and the teacher told me not to get in fights, and it was just like a combination of between my mom and my teacher, just listening to them and not paying attention. And I did grow thick skin. And now I'm all like, hey, you could talk all you want, and I'm not really concerned about what you're saying. Yeah. It was a tough time. I got over it. And nowadays, it's like, okay, I'm going to have a long beard because I want to. You're not going to tell me anything. So it is what it is. And my relationship with my dad, ever since forever ago, I had to learn how to accept the fact that when my dad told me he loved me when he was drunk, not to believe it. Just turn off my emotions. That's always been like very tough. Like it's not something that a kid should hear from a drunk dad. And a dad shouldn't say that. But when I heard it, I wanted to believe it. At the same time, I wanted to hear it from him when he was in his five senses. He was very tough on me, very strict. You know, wake up in the morning and do chores. It was an abusive time for my dad, and just getting breaking out of a cycle of obedience for an abusive dad. It was a very difficult time. But I, you know, we learned through help with psychologists and accepting that if my dad wasn't willing to change his being drunk, we couldn't change him either. And that's something you gotta accept that for him to help himself, And for us, for our well-being, to understand that if he doesn't help himself, nobody can. That has been, very difficult, but at the same time, we need to learn how to do it, and we did.
Change his attitude right now.
So my dad had a very bad accident. He's a landscaper. He fell out of a truck, and he had to stop drinking. So that was good, right? But then when he started doing exams on, he always knew that he had diabetes. But they specified that if he kept on his route, he would die. And we had two of my uncles, one of them died for smoking and a poor immune system, and the other uncle died because of over drinking and just drinking himself to death. So he saw those firsthand, and those were the people that he hung out with. So he learned really quickly. And also, the same uncle that died from drinking, he his immune system went really bad. So once they told him he had diabetes, he kind of stopped drinking as much and hanging out with people that he shouldn't be hanging out. And now that he has my children and my sister's children, he sees them growing and now he spends time with them. More so than he spent time with us. It sucks, but at the same time, it's an amazing thing to walk with them and be with them and carry them and grandfather in, so we're hunting for that. I still love my dad for as long as I live. Even if he's a grandfather, however he is, he's still going to be my dad. So.
I'm very excited to see you, Lorenzo. And as a new immigrant, I come here for 1 year and I'm still studying English now. And I should be thanking Ms. Professor Andy. And she asked my first question to you. And I really want to know if you can open your restaurant in the Bay Area. And the second, we know every immigrant should be have very hard choice. And I want to know if you have a choice to be an engineer, will you be it? If you have a choice to be an engineer, will you be an engineer or?
Yes. If I had a chance to be an engineer? Okay. Yes, I would. And I do have an offer, but I can't take it because I'm too busy, woman. No, I'm playing. but I am pretty busy, and I do want to do it. But I feel like giving it is more my thing, and I want to do it. I will. You know what? Once I become a powerful chef, and everybody knows me, and I have time, I will go back. I will definitely do something about it.
I'm an engineer now. I know I could,
actually.
Yeah. I am building it myself.
Which one is your best theory? Curry, the engineer, or the restaurant owner?
They're both like engineers. It's
possible. So they're half and half.
I'm also thinking about ways to modernize my cooking. Sometimes I want to figure out how to make things that I don't have to worry about. Sometimes there's dishes that I'm I can take because I make empanadas fresh, like chorizo empanadas. I made a French one with brie and things like that. So different flavor cuisines of empanadas. But how do I make it so that I don't have to worry about packaging so much, because usually we're doing 300 or 400 of those little things, in one day. So, anyways. But yeah, I'm
thinking about how to do that. Two things.
Okay, here.
Hi, Lorenzo. My name is Lula. I'm from America. Welcome and thank you for coming to share your experience with us. And my question is, I would like to know how you felt when you were at the 2014 migration after you went. And you tell me, because you guys were hard for this competition, especially you and Oscar. You worked for a whole night, you didn't play. And
how you felt after you won the competition, and how you your family's feel? How did you get your family's feeling after you go on to Arizona, especially you, man?
You guys are asking amazing questions. I don't know.
You're running out of words. Really good question. The first time that we won was super difficult. Well, it wasn't super difficult. It was more like, wow, we won. But how do we know how to feel about winning? Because we didn't know what it meant. I honestly didn't know who MIT was. I didn't know who all the colleges was. I didn't know what it meant to you know, win through all this time. Coming back home, my parents didn't know any of the information. They didn't know any of the colleges. They didn't know what the competition, winning that competition meant. So we won, but at the same time, it was normal. It was like, cool, you know? But then the teachers put it into perspective, told me who these colleges were, Christian, but I didn't really care who they were, actually. We beat them, they're not better enough, right? So MIT, Caltech, the top engineering universities, we beat them. Does that mean that they're not the top engineering universities anymore? I don't know. What really matters is that we didn't do it once, we did it three times. And at the year after, we actually knew. We actually knew who we were competing against, and we learned the importance of doing the things we were doing. And it wasn't just because of us, it was overall because of all the students after us, you know? How are we gonna set that bar high enough again? And once we started winning and the students started seeing, all the students that were coming, they were coming in from all different regions of Arizona. Phoenix. So they're coming from other school districts to come to our high school because they knew that the high school had importance to it. You know, you want to become an engineer, you go to Carl Hayden because of the robotics team. And once you have that, you know, because we have that Falcon Robotics, Carl Hayden High School student, then people will be like, okay, this guy knows what he's talking about. He knows what he's doing. He knows what he wants. And that's a reputation that we've changed from being a gang school to being a robotics school. So now, my mom is proud, but not until we got the documentary. We got the movie, and I got fired from my job, and now she sees that I'm not living paycheck to paycheck. But it took 10 years, you know? And now she knows the importance of the things that I'm doing. But I'm telling you, I made her cry. I made her upset. I sacrificed my dental health. But she was like, well, why don't you go get your braces? I'm like, no, I want to build robots. So I built robots, and I gave up my health, but at the same time, I got something more in return, you know? So I think now she feels proud.
Thank you for being here. Today, the question I want to ask you, what made you and your teammates success in the competition?
Really good question. I started noticing something when I started giving these talks, and that was that we always knew that we were not competing against them. We were there to learn. Remember, we were like, oh, we're gonna go learn so that next year we can compete against them. Well, doing that, we set ourselves in our own level, in a level that we weren't competing against them. We were learning for ourselves so that we could come back next year and improve that. So I want to say that we were on our own level, that we weren't competing against them, and that we weren't paying attention to the competition that was around us. We were paying attention to what we had, and because we knew that these competitors were way better than what we were. I don't even give them time of the day. So when we started getting, you know, the technical document, and we were English as a second learner, you know, getting first place in that, it wasn't a really thing. Because now we knew that we could explain things in writing and do it so well that we got first place. You know, in a level of competition that we otherwise wouldn't be able to compete against. So that, you know, gave us an idea. And then, you know, winning the special award, man, like, who would have thought we'd throw tampons in the robot and we would get a special award, right? Right? I mean, it's those little things that started adding up. And then when we win, it made sense. Like, we were able to compete because we're on our own level. We weren't competing against Laney College. We weren't competing against MIT. We were competing against ourselves just so that we could see that we could do it. And I think that's what made us successful at those times. And then the fact that we were able to replicate it 3 times, be on top of MIT every time and be on top 3, then we could be consistent. We could be competitive. We could be the Carl Hayden High School that everybody loves. Anyways, thank you guys so much for your time.
Hold up, I'm not done.
So I have these things, and if you guys would like me to sign one or your books, I can do that.
And so thank you so much. Again, we are honored for you to be here, and we have some snacks back there, and if you can stay and mingle, it would be great, and Lorenzo can buy your book or the postcards from Underwater Dreams. If you have not seen Underwater Dreams, it's one of the best documentaries I've ever seen, so it's really worthwhile. Thank you, everybody, for coming.